you when they want you. I know they see you when they want to make you who they want you to be. I know that life is trying to get you. I know that life is calling out to you by your name. But don't listen, resist it, keep running. Don't you stop for nothing, just keep kicking. Remember where you came from, don't forget what you already know. What you got is amazing, hold that, don't you let it go. You hold the light, you hold the light. You hold the light and it's shining and making darker places brighter, you lighter. You hold the light, you got a lot. You bring a lot and it's evident. They could see it, they won't end it. But it's not for the taking, it's not for the changing. No, it's not for remixing, it's not for remaking, alright. So they lining up to take it, alright. I can't let them take my you, you know I ride for you, yeah. I won't let them take you, I'll be your direction, yeah, I'll be your protector. You know I ride, I fight for you, I'll fight for you, I'll fight for you. You know I'm fighting cause I refuse to lose you.
A brilliant young African was killed a few weeks ago, Thomas Sankara. Now, he was president of Burkina Faso, formerly called Upper Volta. Now, he had gone to a meeting previously with African heads of state. And at that meeting, he made a speech. He said, all of you are wearing shirts from France, shoes from England. I'm the only one here African enough to wear a pair of shoes made by my people with leather tanned and processed by my people in our own country. Then he showed his shoes and just as good looking as the other shoes. Why don't you Africans at least learn to make the clothes you wear? In less than a month, he was dead. Because no one intends to let African people program themselves, support themselves, clothe themselves, feed themselves, school themselves, no place on the face of this earth.
It comes as a great shock to discover that the country which is your birthplace and to which you owe your life and your identity has not in its whole system of reality evolved any place for you. Comes as a great shock around the age of 5 or 6 or 7 to discover the flag to which you have pledged allegiance along with everybody else has not pledged allegiance to you. It comes as a great shock to discover that Gary Cooper killing off the Indians when you were rooting for Gary Cooper, that the Indians were you. When I was growing up, I was taught in American history books that Africa had no history, and neither did I. That I was a savage, about whom the less said the better, who had been saved by Europe and brought to America. And of course, I believed it. I didn't have much choice. Those were the only books there were. I am stating very seriously, and this is not an overstatement, I picked the cotton, and I carried its market, and I built the railroads under someone else's whip for nothing. For nothing. If one has got to prove one's title to the land, isn't 400 years enough? 400 years, at least 3 wars. The American soil is full of the corpses of my ancestors. Why is my freedom or my citizenship or my right to live there? How is it conceivably a question now? What we are not facing is the results of what we've done. what one begs the American people to do for all our sakes is simply to accept our history until the moment comes when we, the American people, we are trying to forge a new identity for which we need each other. Until this moment, there is scarcely any hope for the American dream, because the people who are denied participation in it, by their very presence, will wreck it.
As a kid, you've definitely heard about famous inventions like the light bulb, the telephone, and the television. These have, without a doubt, made life easier and more entertaining. But there are a ton of other inventions that are often overlooked. These are some of the top inventions made by Black women. Number 1. Alice Parker. Invention: natural gas heating system. In the early 20th century, people relied on wood and coal to heat their homes. Alice Parker was an African American who came up with a revolutionary idea: a central heating system that uses natural gas. With it, people wouldn't have to go out, collect, and chop wood. It was convenient and produced enough heat for a home to get through the cold winters. It also reduced the risk of fires because there was no need for the fireplace to burn at night. On December 23, 1919, her invention, called the heating surface, received a patent, but it was never put into commercial production. Still, it plays a key role in the development of the heating systems we have today. Number 2. Marie Van Britten Brown. Invention: home security system. Marie Brown was a Black woman who invented the first closed-circuit television security system. In 1966, Marie, with the help of her husband, created a system that would help them see who is at the front door. She used a sliding camera, 4 peepholes, TV monitors, and 2-way microphones. This was the start of modern-day CCTV. Of course, the invention was much bulkier and took up more space than today's security systems, but it was such a renowned invention that it was recognized in the New York Times. Marie also got an award from the National Scientists Committee. Number 3. Sarah Elizabeth Goode. Invention: folding cabinet bed. In the late 1800s, apartments were very small units. People had limited space, and many couldn't fit the kind of furniture we use today. Goode wanted to offer people the convenience of everyday furniture without sacrificing too much living space. She invented space-saving furniture known as the folding cabinet bed. Her folding cabinet could be used as a desk. The desk also had a couple of compartments for stationery and writing supplies. This meant extra storage and more furniture. She received a patent for her invention on July 14, 1885. Goode was one of the first known Black women to receive a U.S. patent. This folding cabinet bed would go on to become the modern-day Murphy bed. Number 4. Patricia Bath. Invention: laser phaco. Dr. Bath changed the face of medicine. She was a laser scientist and ophthalmologist. In 1986, she invented a new technique and device for cataract surgery called laser phaco. This method helped remove cataracts, which are a major cause of blindness. This invention harnessed laser technology. It created a more precise and less painful cataract treatment. Dr. Bath was the first Black woman doctor to get a patent in the medical field, which is a mostly male-dominated industry. She also holds patents in Europe, Canada, and Japan. Number 5. Miriam E. Benjamin. Invention: gong and signal chair for hotels. In 1888, Miriam Benjamin received a patent for a chair that would decrease the expenses of hotels by reducing the number of attendants and waiters. The goal was to add comfort and convenience for guests. It would remove the need to call and hand clap to get the necessary services. Here is how her invention worked. There was a button on the back of the chair. After pressing it, it would send a signal to a waiter. A light on the chair would stay on to notify the waiter of which guest needs assistance. This invention is the predecessor of the modern-day airplane signaling system for stewardesses. Number 6. Marjorie Joyner. Invention: permanent hair weave machine and scalp protector. Marjorie Joyner was an African-American businesswoman and beautician. She was known for creating a new device for curling hair. At the time, Black women were using hot curling irons to style their hair, but it took a very long time, and women could only use one iron at a time. To speed up the hair waving process, she created a device that used multiple rods hung above the client's head. These rods then roll a couple of sections of the hair at once. It heats the hair and creates a hairstyle that it can hold for days. In 1928, Joyner received a patent for her invention. Salons quickly started using it. A year later, she also received a patent for a scalp protector. Number 7. Sarah Boone. Invention: the ironing board. Sarah Boone wasn't the first person to invent an ironing board, but was the first woman to create an improvement to the ironing board. In the 1800s, people would heat irons on a fire or a stove. They would then cover a table with a thick cloth, usually a kitchen table. Those who could afford it would prop an ironing board. At the time, ironing boards were bulky and wide. Boone's improved ironing board was designed to be effective for ironing ladies' garments and sleeves. It was curved, narrow, and reversible. This made it easy to iron sleeves on both sides. Number 8. Ellen Eglin. Invention: clothes wringer. Ellen Eglin was an African-American inventor who revolutionized the chore of laundry. She created a clothes wringer that would help wash and dry clothes faster. In the 1800s, laundry was backbreaking work. People would have to scrub clothes by hand, wring out the water, and hang them out to dry. Eglin decided to change things with a new device. The clothes wringer came with two wooden rollers. After washing and rinsing the clothes, people could feed the clothes into the wooden rollers and squeeze the water out. The wringer significantly reduced the washing process and the effort it took to do the laundry. Number 9. Linda D. Newman. Invention: hairbrush with synthetic bristles. In 1898, Linda Newman received a patent for her improved hairbrush design. Thanks to her experience as a hairdresser and black woman, she created a more practical, efficient, and affordable hairbrush. During that period, most hairbrushes were made of animal hair, but the bristles were too soft to handle thicker hair. Synthetic fibers were more durable and easier to work with. The brush had bristles that were evenly dispersed, including a compartment that would collect debris. With a simple push of a button, the user can clean the compartment. It was convenient, effective, and easier to manufacture. We've been lied to about who we truly are and our history all of our lives, which is how they keep us stuck and confused. But it's time to change the narrative and tell our own stories and history. That's exactly why we made our new ebook called The Root. It breaks down our real history, the traps that keep us stuck in the system, and how to become the best version of yourself. Click the link in our description to grab yours now for 75% off. Number 10. Bessie Blunt. Invention: feeding device for amputees. Blunt was one of the few black physical therapists at the time. During World War II, she realized that much of the equipment was inadequate, especially when it came to the treatment of veteran amputees. She taught patients innovative ways to use their feet. She also created a feeding device that would help patients eat comfortably and independently in a level or upright position. In 1951, Blunt received a patent for her apparatus, known as the portable receptacle support. Number 11. Mary Kenner. Invention: sanitary belt, attachment for wheelchair or walker, toilet paper holder, and mounted back massager and washer. Mary Kenner is the first black woman to have the most patents. She was born in 1912 and received a patent in 1957 for the sanitary belt. Although she originally invented the sanitary belt in the 1920s, she didn't have the funds for a patent. She later improved the product. The goal of her invention was to prevent menstrual blood from leaking on clothes. This was a common problem for ladies. In 1976, she also invented an attachment for a wheelchair or walker. It came with a soft pocket and a hard surface tray that could carry items. A couple of years later, in 1982, she invented the toilet paper holder. This product resembles much of the toilet paper holders we use today. Her last patent was for a mounted back massager and washer granted in 1987. All her inventions were aimed at improving convenience for users and quality of life. Countless modern-day conveniences come from the accomplishments of men, but many black women have also left a mark on history. Despite the numerous obstacles of sexism and racism, they created countless technologies, devices, and products that contributed to the way we use things today. Their innovations used commonly available tools and were bulkier than today's products, but they helped scientists revolutionize modern devices and improve quality of life. Which of these inventions is your favorite? Is there an invention you think deserves a spot on this list? Let us know in the comments section below. If you'd like to learn some more about black history that they never taught us in school, I highly recommend for you to click the video on the screen. It's an unbelievable story that you must hear. We'll see you over there.
I could start this story in 1847, when this region in West Africa officially became the nation of Liberia, elevated to be the second black republic in the world after Haiti at the time. Or I could start it more than a century later, when back-to-back civil wars ravaged the nation due to sustained economic and political suppression. Or I could start it today and talk about how 5% of Liberia's population of 5 million people is descended from African American settlers. For me, the story of Liberia started taking shape most directly in 1816, when the number of free blacks in the United States was on a steady rise. That was when a group of Americans founded the American Colonization Society, ACS, to deal with the problem of the growing number of free blacks in the United States by resettling them in Africa. The biggest question at the time facing the leaders of America was what to do about slavery, whether to continue, whether to abolish it, whether the country could really be a home to free black people and enslaved black people at the same time. This was about 40 years before the United States would abolish slavery. Welcome to Reason Africa. The idea of an African-American colony in Africa was a fascinating question, with an obvious answer to many in the United States, but with a more complicated explanation. A colony for blacks outside the United States had been proposed several times, beginning in the 1700s, but it was the American Colonization Society's formation in 1816 that provided the impetus to make it a reality. The Colonization Society attracted a mixed bag of supporters. Slave owners pushed for free black people to be sent away from the United States because, according to them, they undermined the institution of slavery. They could have helped other slaves escape or, even worse, rebel. 5 years after its formation, the ACS launched its first trip to Liberia and founded a settlement and named it Monrovia, after US President James Monroe, which later became the capital of Liberia, the oldest modern republic in the region. Over the decades, the number of blacks sailing to Liberia steadily increased. Upwards of 12,000 freeborn and formerly enslaved black Americans out of an approximate 4 million of them emigrated to Africa. The widely expected mass exodus of African Americans to Liberia never materialized in the grand scale it was expected. However, the settlers built schools, churches, and roads, and formed a government modeled on the United States systems. The only problem was that the area already had inhabitants, and they were not very happy to see newcomers come in and take their land. The relations of the African-American settlers with the natives were strained right from the get-go. The natives saw the black Americans as no more than dark-skinned occupiers. On the other hand, the African-American settlers regarded the natives as uncivilized. The settlers marginalized the indigenous population and reduced them to the status of servitude. The fact that the freed enslaved who opted to return to Africa, where they hoped to enjoy complete liberty, would oppress other Africans is one of the ironies of history. By the 1840s, many European countries had established colonies around Liberia and were pressuring the colony, the ACS, and even the United States to clarify Liberia's role and identity. Could Liberia broker treaties and trade agreements? Could it levy taxes? And could England or France annex the area if it was not claimed by any other country? Joseph Jenkins Roberts, a man born free in Virginia, who was the colony's first black governor in 1841, declared Liberia's independence in 1847 in efforts to establish a sovereign state and was elected president the next year. The Declaration of Independence made Liberia the first black-ruled republic in Africa. But simmering tensions between the settlers and the indigenous people continued to grow and fester within the new nation. Many of the immigrants died due to diseases, countless wars with the natives and other causes. Yet, little by little, they established themselves as elites. Due to fears of the impact a free nation could have had on the issue of slavery in the United States, America did not recognize the nation it had played a role in creating until much later. Many people believe it's an oversimplification to say that African Americans colonized Liberia. So let's investigate and share your thoughts in the comment section below. When the first settlers came ashore in the region, they were not welcomed, not really. The immigrants' takeover of land and the injection of US customs and religion into their culture was resented by locals. Some mainstream scholars have argued that, in a sense, Liberia is a mirror image of the United States and its conquest and later settlement by Europeans. The American Colonial Society acquired Cape Mesurado, a 36-kilometer-long strip of land near present-day Monrovia, from the then indigenous ruler with a threat of force if he declined to sell. The colony was extended along the coast as well as inland by use of force against native tribes. The immigrants created the same exclusionary practices they left behind in the States and, intentional or not, sowed the seeds for future civil conflict. They took a completely new political system that the natives knew nothing about and dominated the political system for almost 150 years. This is linked to a little-known historical fact, a short-lived nation called the Republic of Maryland, which comprised of black emigrants from the U.S. state of Maryland before merging with the Republic of Liberia. Upon formation of modern Liberia, Americo-Liberians treated the natives as white Americans had treated them, as second-class citizens and not deserving of the vote, very similar to South Africa's apartheid struggle that was dominated by an elite minority group who kept a tight rein on power. It was not until the 1940s that the native Africans got the right to vote in national elections. You'd imagine that since the immigrants who are former slaves themselves would know what it feels like to be subjugated and oppressed, instead, they established their own system of oppression and domination. All economic and political power in the country was concentrated through the True Whig Party. They controlled the government, the economy, and the state. Another issue at play was slavery. It was widely understood that African natives benefited from slavery by selling some Americo-Liberian ancestors into slavery in the Americas, as they were middlemen in the business. So perhaps this was a contributing factor why Americo-Liberians didn't cut any favors to the natives. In a short amount of time, abuse ensued. Lack of property rights for natives and forced labor without pay was the order of the day, which prompted a League of Nations investigation. Their report was damning. They found that certain Liberian officials forced natives to work on projects and even sent them out to labor on plantations abroad. Intimidation, humiliation, and compulsion were common methods used. Unfortunately, although the United States stood in an essentially similar relationship to Liberia as Britain did to Sierra Leone, and more distantly as France does to its former colonies in West Africa, it consequently avoided the duties implicit in that relationship. In spite of American enormous influence there, the United States never seriously urged reform against the oppression of natives by the elite of Liberia's ruling class. Tensions finally boiled over in 1980 when indigenous Africans carried out a coup which marked an end to the settlers' dominance as well as the beginning of 16 years of political instability. From there, we all know how the story went. Charles Taylor was found guilty by the ICC and is currently serving time for war crimes. With increasing intermarriages in recent decades and warming of relations between Americo-Liberians and indigenous Liberians, the Republic of Liberia is today a stable democracy and is continuing its journey of development as a strong member of the community of nations. America's influence remains strong in the country. The Liberian flag closely resembles the stars and the stripes of the US flag. Some architecture in the country resembles 19th century houses. English is the official language, and the US dollar is generally accepted as currency. I hope you enjoyed the video, guys. Please hit like and subscribe if you did. I also want to thank our great supporters on Patreon, whose generous contributions allow us to keep expanding and creating more high-quality content. If you'd like to help out with the channel, please head over to patreon.com/reasonafrica. That's patreon.com/reasonafrica. Thank you so much for watching. I'll see you next time.
A lot of you listening may know about the legend of Forsyth County in 1912 and how 1,100 residents, black residents, were ran out of the county after two women were raped. But let me tell you about Oscarville, Georgia. Oscarville, Georgia was a town that was mainly black owned. Most of the residents that were ran out of Forsyth County, they took residence in Oscarville, Georgia. Now, Oscarville, Georgia was where the supposed rape of the white woman, May Crow, went down by what was described as four black teenagers.
According to various accounts, 18-year-old May Crow is walking alone in the woods when she's struck repeatedly with a rock, reportedly sexually assaulted and left for dead.
She was hit so hard that her eye was dislodged from her skull and left hanging.
She's always kind of center.
Debbie Vermont is May Crow's grandniece. She keeps a portrait of her in her living room.
My grandmother always said that she was known to be the prettiest girl in Forsyth County.
Word of the attack spread quickly. Suspicion soon fell on a group of young African Americans. Local media condemned them, describing the trio as, quote, the fiendish, low-browed, guerrilla-type Negroes. Enraged by the news, a mob immediately lynched one man.
You believe that some of your distant relatives took part in this lynching?
Yes, some of them. I am fairly sure they did. These were the most aggrieved and grieving, who wanted justice for what had happened to their loved one.
Two others, both teenagers, were arrested, tried, and convicted. A prominent doctor volunteered land near his home for the court-ordered execution. An estimated 5,000 people showed up to watch the hangings.
Well, my grandmother would have been 18 months old sitting in her mother's lap.
Watching someone being lynched.
Right.
So do you believe that those three people, the two teenagers, the one young man in his 20s, do you believe they were innocent?
I do believe they were innocent. I do believe, and I believe it's a huge cold case that's still sitting there to try to figure out exactly who did.
Now, this particular town had houses, stores, barns, probably churches, and a racetrack. The location of the town is now located under the popular Lake Lanier. If you look up Oscarville, Georgia, in your Google search, it will pull up Lake Lanier. Now, we already know that Lake Lanier is a man-made lake that was made to make sure that Georgia was always replenished with water. It was dammed up and it was flooded. But let me give you a little bit more information about it. As they started to run out these 1,100 residents of Oscarville, what they didn't tell you was that some of the residents actually decided to stay and not get ran out of town by this white militia. The ones that did decide to stay hid and camped out in different wooded areas of the Oscarville area.
11 people have died in drowning or boating accidents on Lake Lanier this year, including a father and son. Charged with responding to all of those calls are divers with the local fire department.
11 Alive's Caitlin Ross shows you what they deal with under the surface of Lake Lanier, its dangerous and deadly environment.
You get yourself in trouble really quickly.
Lanier was built in the 1950s to provide drinking water and hydroelectric power for Atlanta. Recreation was an afterthought.
As they were building the lake, they raised the water level up to a certain point well below what we know of today as full pool. and then stopped filling the water.
From there, construction crews floated on the lake, cutting off the trees about halfway.
So today, those stumps are still there, and they're tall because this was forest land and farmland.
Also beneath the surface, old homes, barns, even a racetrack, which famously surfaced during the 2007 drought. You could see the tops of the stands, a haunted memory, waiting for spectators to show up for the next race.
They blew the old bridges in place, so you have concrete, rebar.
The divers work in teams, one person in the water and the other on the shore. They're tethered together by a rope and communicate by tugs on the rope. Divers say they never know what they're going to find.
So now, when you go to Lake Lanier, if you were to dive under Lake Lanier, you would find a barn, houses, probably even churches, a bridge, and a racetrack. This is the history that Georgia has been hiding from us for so many years, and now it's starting to come out. So please be careful going for a swim in Lake Lanier, because there is a doomed history up under that lake. And as the woman had already said, 11 people have died this year, and many people have died since the lake was dammed up and flooded. If y'all would like me to do more stories like this, please share this story with people that you know would be interested in it. And also make sure that you come back and tune into my Facebook timeline, as I will be dropping more historical things just like this. Until next time, y'all.
Like this.